Hello everyone and welcome to Fixing Disney Star Wars. This is episode 5 in our commentary series for the Senate Cut of The Last Jedi. Thanks for joining us today. The purpose of the Senate Cut of this film is to build a better episode 8. Please subscribe and like our videos so that we can place higher in the YouTube algorithm, and please let us know in the comments what you did or did not like about episode 8 and what you hope to see changed. If you like our work, please consider joining our Subscribestar. If you don't know, Subscribestar is a membership platform similar to Patreon, but respects a creator's freedom of speech and expression. In a time where people all around the world are being increasingly censored, it's important to us as a team that we support platforms that are advocating for the basic human rights and freedoms for people all around the world. On Subscribestar, you'll find things like exclusive content, exclusive videos, new commentaries, VFX tests, and more. And all funds go to help fund our edits. We don't keep anything. If you're interested in helping and supporting us, the link for our Subscribestar is in our description. And now with the intro out of the way, let's get to the commentary. We start off this week with the sequence where Finn and Rose are infiltrating the Star Destroyer with DJ. Our first edit occurs when the trio are walking down a corridor. In the original cut, Finn says almost there, but we've removed this line because, in our opinion, it interferes with the pacing of the scene, which should be quite frantic and have a certain momentum to it. In the Senate cut, we now see the trio walking with a sense of purpose, keeping tight-lipped and trying not to tip off anyone to their presence on the ship. Moving along, we come to the elevator scene between Rey and Kylo Ren. Now, this scene has been brought up a number of times in the Fixing Disney Star Wars team's brainstorming sessions, and we've also seen this sequence brought up in online forums and YouTube comments. In short, this sequence, along with the sequence wherein Snoke shows Rey that the Resistance is being destroyed through a window out into the battle, is often cited as an example of Rian Johnson's lack of creativity when it came to writing the Last Jedi script. And there's merit to the argument, because these two small sequences feel like a copy and paste from Return of the Jedi. With The Force Awakens already being a near-complete ripoff of A New Hope, fans were expecting something completely new and different with this film. And Lucas was able to create an entire new trilogy in the prequels without ever having ripped off or having to copy his original trilogy. So it is surprising that in all three of the sequel trilogy films, there's a direct or new indirect ripoff from the original trilogy placed about. The goal with our edit in this sequence was to make it less similar to his equivalent in The Return of the Jedi. To make this happen, we've removed Rey's line where she says, quote, "I feel the conflict in you, it's tearing you apart," as well as the "just the shape of it was solid and clear." These lines were removed because it has literally been a matter of days since the events of The Force Awakens. And while the Ortega cut does show Rey being trained, it's only for a few days. This film does not have the benefit of implied training between films, unlike, say, the gap between A New Hope and The Empire Strikes Back, or between The Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi. This is literally days after Rey leaves Jakku, and Daisy Ridley's delivery here is also of a confident tone, and more so than what one would expect from a simple trainee, or Padawan, if you will. Now, if she were related to Anakin, this sort of confidence wouldn't be out of place, as this was a character flaw that was also seen in Anakin, as Anakin was often big-headed. However, Rey is not related to Anakin in any way. Additionally, we have removed Ben's quote, "Because of what I saw, I know that when the moment comes, you'll be the one to turn. You'll stand with me," line. Ben obviously has more training, so it's far more likely that he's actually seen something. However, we've cut this line to make the scene play differently. In the Senate cut, we see the two in the elevator when Rey says, "You don't have to do this. Ben, when I touched your hands, I saw your future. You will not bow before Snoke. You'll turn and I'll help you." And Ben now replies with, "I saw something too. I saw who your parents are." So why this change? Because firstly, it now sounds like Ben is mocking her when he says that he's seen something. And second, if Ben is telling the truth, it shows that he's intentionally keeping Rey's most sought-after information from her. It illustrates that Kylo is more of a cold-hearted individual, and that he takes a certain pleasure from torturing Rey by not giving her the information she so desperately seeks. It also shows Rey's naivety regarding the situation she's in. She's over her head, but she doesn't know it. We next come to the throne room scene, where Rey is finally introduced to Snoke. And during this scene, we've added the Emperor's theme as a foreshadow of Palpatine's return and because of his involvement with Snoke. Because in our version of the sequel trilogy, Palpatine is in literal control of Snoke's thoughts, though Snoke believes himself to be acting under his own agency. And we continue this trend throughout Rey's interaction with Snoke because, in addition to foreshadowing, it also adds a sense of foreboding, that Snoke is far more dangerous than we've been led on to believe. When we get to the scene where Snoke pulls Rey closer to him, she says, "You underestimate Luke Skywalker, and Ben Solo, and me." But in the Senate cut, Rey now just says, "You underestimate Skywalker and Ben Solo." The reasoning here is that Rey isn't supposed to know she's strong in the Force. Kylo Ren made this clear in The Force Awakens when he says, "She's strong with the Force, stronger than she knows." Rey should not be this confident or this arrogant only a few days into training. Also, it's likely that both Snoke and Palpatine do not see Rey as a legitimate threat. If they did, they wouldn't bring her before either one of them. Yet they do, both here and in The Rise of Skywalker. And why is Rey not a threat? Because Palpatine, who is ultimately in control of Snoke, knows exactly who she is, exactly where she came from, and exactly what she is capable of, which at this point in the film is of no concern to Palpatine, who ultimately is in control of everything happening in this film, The Force Awakens, and in Episode 9. Additionally, in the original cut, Snoke talks about Skywalker and Ben after this comment, but not Rey. It's clear that with Palpatine as Snoke, he was aware of the risk posed to him from Vader, and he understands that Ben may also pose the same risk as well. He also understands the risk that Luke poses to him. But Rey poses no risk whatsoever at this point in the sequel trilogy. Next, we come to the scene aboard the Star Destroyer where Finn and Rose are on their knees in front of General Hux and Captain Phasma. In the original cut, Hux slaps Finn, but we've removed this slap because it's effeminate in its execution, and it's used to show Hux as an individual who cannot wait to take his anger out on Finn. However, there's something far more terrifying about a military villain and tactician who doesn't allow his emotions to rule his actions, but is instead far more calculating and more complex in how he conducts himself. We envision Hux not slapping Finn here because something far worse awaits him behind closed doors. There's no rush to punish Finn right now, because in Hux's view, he'll get his just reward. Ivan Ortega rightfully removed Rose's childish bite scene here, which was another great edit in our opinion. Returning to the throne room scene, we see that Rey attempts to pull the Skywalker saber from Snoke's throne, but is unsuccessful. And in the original cut, it is here that the second Return of the Jedi ripoff scene takes place, wherein Snoke shows Rey her failing resistance fleet as they attempt to make their way to Crait. Ivan Ortega rightfully removed this scene, but we've taken things up a step further in our edit. In the Senate cut, the scene plays as follows. Snoke drops Rey to the ground, laughs, and says, "Well, well, I did not expect Skywalker to be so wise, hiding himself away from me much like Kenobi before him. And now the final failure of the Jedi Order is complete. We will give him and the Jedi Order the death he desires. After the rebels are gone, we will go to his planet and obliterate the entire island." Rey attempts to force pull the lightsaber from Snoke and gets hit in the head. Snoke then says, "Such spunk," then uses the Force to rotate Rey to face Ben. We then see the scene where Ben is tempted by Snoke to kill Rey. We've removed Ren's, quote, "I know what I have to do here" line because it gives a slight glimmer of hope that maybe he won't kill Rey. By removing this line, the audience truly doesn't know what Ben is about to do, and we can see an internal struggle occurring here on Ben's face, something that is largely not present in the original cut as it stands right now. It is here that we also hear Palpatine's disembodied voice say, quote, "Fulfill your destiny," as Snoke says the same. And right before Ren kills Snoke, Palpatine's disembodied voice yet again appears saying, "Do it." This is not taken from Episode 3, by the way, but from an interview with Ian McDiarmid. It is a completely different take on that line. And the idea here is that Palpatine is pushing Ben more and more to the dark side by killing each father figure or mentor he has, or attempting to. He tried to kill Luke, he did kill Han, and now he kills Snoke. This adds consistency to his character and better establishes a pattern of his behavior. And now, when we see Ben threaten to kill Palpatine at the beginning of Episode 9, this is an established character trait. Ben constantly has the need to kill those or remove those who exercise some sort of power or authority over him. Well, that'll do it for Episode 5 in our Senate Cut commentary series. But we'll be back next week with Episode 6. What did you like most about The Last Jedi, and what did you dislike? Let us know in the comments below, and don't forget to drop a like or comment as well. Thanks again for watching, and until next time, may the Force be with you.